been here many times before. I'm very glad to be able to share this bandstand with these wonderful musicians. It's good to be black in LA. It's good to be back in LA, of course. Being black, it's got its perks. No one here is old enough to remember this guy, Burt Williams, the comedian from way back in the day. And somebody once asked him, said, "Oh, well, you know, Mr. Williams, certainly, you know, being black must be problematic for you in this country." He says, "You know, I have no problem with being a black man, although it's just a bit of an inconvenience at times." But very glad to be able to share this music with you and to be here in this room. And we hope that you enjoy the music that you're going to hear. So please say hello to Mr. Luca Alemanno on the bass. Luca Alemanno. And on the drums, the legend, Mr. Kevin Kanner. Kevin Kanner. Come on. So we're going to play a wide variety of things. You know me, I like to mix it up and play original music. I love to play Thelonious Monk, and I love to honor all of my West Coast heroes and mentors. So we'll be doing all of that in this set and the next set over the next couple of nights. We're going to open up with a composition, one of my favorites, by the great Benny Golson. How about a hand for Benny Golson? Yeah. He got to be 110 now, isn't he? Golson, he's at least 92. That means he's 95. Golson is hanging in there. That, I mean, Golson's still with us. Lou Donaldson. Lou Donaldson ain't going nowhere. He's going to outlive all of us. George Coleman. Roy Haynes. This is unbelievable. Ron Carter's getting up there. He ain't 90 yet, though. There's a few of them still. Barry Harris. They're hanging in there. They're going to be swinging long after we're gone. But thank God for Benny Golson. Benny Golson wrote this beautiful composition entitled Stable Mates, and we hope you enjoy it. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
much. Kevin Canner on the drums. Let's hear it for Kevin Canner. Luca Alemanno on the bass. Luca Alemanno. Thank you. That was a composition by the great Thelonious Monk entitled Gallops Gallop. To my knowledge, I think he only recorded that twice that I know of. Of course, they're always finding lost tapes in people's basements and yard sales and flea markets and things. They always pop up somebody holding one from they have no idea what he has. Do you hear about the story about the some mattress? Somebody gave away a mattress that had like $1,000 or $1 million hidden in it or something like that. It's just these crazy urban legends. Anyway, that's why I sleep on a futon. Anyway, that solves that problem right there. So we're going to continue on with a composition by the great Charlie Parker, something that he wrote called Moose the Mooch. And apparently Moose the Mooch was right here in Los Angeles in the 90s. Uh-oh, somebody knew Moose? maybe you might want to hush. you might want to, so I don't want to, you know, in case, but they say you reserve the right to remain silent, something in case used against you in a court of law. Anyway, Moose the Mooch was a hustler, let's say, to put it mildly, a guy by the name of Emory Byrd. Back in, I think, 1946 or 47 when Charlie Parker wrote this composition out here on the West Coast. So this is something that he wrote called Moose the Mooch. Hope you enjoy it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Luca Alemanno. Thank you so much. Yeah, Luca. Sounds like a good name for a song. Luca. We're going to, yes, there you go. Everybody in the band gets copyright, right? So we're going to move on to, this is an original composition that I'd like to dedicate to, I got to be careful with this. You know, we learn as we go. And we've seen a lot of change. We were having some conversations back there in the back about the silent generation and the boomers and all these different labels that we give ourselves, and Gen Z and Gen X and Gen XYZ. And it's troubling because it's so many things to think about. But I have no problem with that when it comes to trying to understand each other, because ultimately that is what humanity is supposed to be all about, us all understanding each other. And you know, you can look around the room and you see various gray hairs and some hairs that are not so gray, and you know, and we all come from different generations and points in time, and we've seen things change and things that we didn't understand when we were 9 and 10. They're more prominent now, and now we have a better understanding. We're learning things all the time. So I was going to say, I want to dedicate this to all of the women in the room, but you might be a man and identify as a woman. I guess this is for you too. I don't really care one way or the other. I really don't. I do not give a shit. I just don't. You know, I play the piano. That's, you know, I'm a piano sexual. I know what this is my baby. Whatever. But this is a beautiful composition that I wrote for beautiful people. I'll just change the title. What the hell? the title was Una Mujer Elegante, but I'll just it's for the ladies. It's for the ladies. You know, it's for the ladies. So here you go. Enjoy.
Life is something, boy. I tell you.
Thank you.
Luca Alemanno. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
We thank you.
Oh, well, listen, I love you. I love you. I always talk about my experiences here in this town. This town, it reminds me of the what was the skit from dating myself, Saturday Night Live from the 1970s with Garrett Morris. And he talks, he plays this this baseball player, who I think is from, who's supposed to be from Puerto Rico, I think. And he says, baseball has been a very, very good to me. And this LA, this town has been very good to me. I've been so fortunate to be able to grow up in such a rich environment of so many wonderful, wonderful, wonderful musicians. In Los Angeles, I think we're just now starting to get our due, you know, with young musicians. In the 50s and the 60s, we had so many fantastic musicians. And then somewhere along the way, like, history didn't really document all of our work properly. You know, and so many cats got lost in the shuffle. People like Sonny Criss. You know, people never talk about Sonny Criss. When Elmo Hope was out here. Red Calendar, we still discuss Red Calendar, but we discuss him as if it was like, you know, ancient Greek. I mean, you know what I'm saying? And like, the older I get, I start to realize these younger musicians, I might as well be Jelly Roll Morton to some of these kids. age is a bitch. It's like, you know, who am I telling? I'm saying, it's like, you know, nobody really prepares you for how things change. Like, they kind of just watch you squirm around, you know, and you're 20 and 25 years old, and you can pop up out the bed and be out the house in 20 minutes and wash and clothes and everything, right? And then nobody ever says, you know, when you get about 45, you got to slow all that down. But they want you to enjoy your life. They don't want you to be thinking about old shit, you know, right? But, like, when I came onto the scene, you know, these cats had been old my entire life. Buddy Collette, Red Calendar, these cats were like 60. And like, I come on the scene, I'm this 18-year-old whippersnapper, and they, you know, take me under their wings, and they treat me like a peer. These guys were the salt of the earth, and they were like my uncles and my granddads. I was so fortunate to have been with Bob Cooper. I'm going way back, you know, Red Calendar, Gerald Wiggins, Buddy Collette. You all remember the bass player Alan Jackson? That's a name you haven't heard in a while. Alan Jackson checked out kind of young. Paul Humphreys. I'm starting to forget shit too. That's what happens. But it's all good. It's a cycle of life, right? But I've been so fortunate to have grown up in such a town of so many wonderful musicians, and I will always remember them. I don't give a shit what history writes. I'm going to remember them here. They're going to be important to me forever. I'll write about them, and I will play them. And who's going to remember me? Oh my God, Luca will remember me. He said, I played with Eric Green way back with all this so and so. You know, I had one. A lot of people might not know. I just recently, within the past year, I moved to Knoxville, Tennessee, and I'm teaching at the University of Tennessee. So yay, Tennessee. Yay. And I had one student who knew absolutely nothing about jazz. So I'm setting that up for you. She knew zero about jazz. So I introduced her to Billie Holiday. And I said, well, listen, you know, check this out, you know, God Bless the Child, and, you know, Summertime, all the, you know, the popular stuff. And the student, she said to me, is he still alive? I said, honey, let's just back up a little bit and start unpacking all of that. But that's not her fault. She's 18. You know, Billie Holiday had been dead. Just, you know, so her parents weren't even, so you have to stop and go, okay, you know what, I'm introducing this person to somebody brand new, and I have to stop. A lot of my students, some of my students have not heard of Charlie Parker, and I sit there and go, you gotta be kidding me. But it is what it is. This is my opera. This is, I get to mold them, I get to funny little young minds, so it's all good. But I've had to revamp. But I've been so wonderful. It's been such a wonderful experience here in Los Angeles. And I prefaced with all of that to introduce this next composition that I'm getting ready to play that I've played before, written by the great Buddy Collette, something that he wrote for his daughter, Sherlan. So this is Cheryl Ann. We hope you enjoy it. And if somebody gets in contact with Cheryl, you please tell her, but make sure she shows up, at least knows that I'm here. But I'll make sure I send her a text myself. That's on me too. But thank you so much. So this is Cheryl Ann. Hope you enjoy it. Very much. Buddy Collette was such an amazing and prolific composer and also quite the musician. I mean, I don't think there was a reed instrument in existence that he didn't play and really helped to open up those doors in the recording studios for musicians in Los Angeles. Not just an important musical figure, but an important figure socially, an important important figure in terms of civil rights. He was quiet, but he did his thing. We're going to play another composition by the great Thelonious Monk. I love Thelonious Monk's music. This is something that he wrote entitled Pannonica. Pannonica, hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
We're going to play a composition by the great John Coltrane, something that he wrote for his first wife, Naima. And it's simply titled Naima. And it's one of the most beautiful compositions, I believe, that he's ever written. Ballads kind of tend to be that way. But when you consider his life, it becomes more than just the name of a song and named after a person that you think you know. Like you think about, you know, the Beatles, Michelle. Or you think about, what's the song by Toto, Rosanna? Missed you all over, Rosanna. It's a great song. I don't know who the hell she is, but it's a wonderful song. But when you know, we know so much about these musicians, with specifically with jazz, we don't just get into the music. We learn a lot about their lives, and even though they're not like rock stars or like, you know, huge pop celebrities, they're very important to us, and we know all about, you know, where they're from and who they played with. We know their whole history. And when you know John Coltrane's story, this song, at least for me, becomes extremely poignant. And you think about all of the struggles that John Coltrane had early in his life. And the funny thing about women, you know, you see, well, no. This is definitely a compliment. So when I say funny thing, I don't mean like as a drag. I mean, you know, it's a peculiar thing, because you are a peculiar species. That's not bullshit, y'all. God made y'all different. I mean, it's just that's the truth. But it's the funny thing about women. You know, you see in men when you marry them, if you marry them, you see something in us that oftentimes we don't see. And whatever it was, I know it's true, that's why I said it. I know this to be true. But, you know, Naima, you know, she saw something. I believe, and, you know, I grew up preacher's kid, you know, but I don't believe that's all there is. You know, there are so many different ways of thinking. And I believe to some degree that Naima actually saw into John Coltrane's future. And women, y'all get it. You got us, even we don't want to be got. But you get us. We keep running, and y'all keep chasing until you find, you know what, just go on ahead, because I can't keep doing this. I'm tired of chasing your ass. But Naima saw, I really believe she saw into John Coltrane's future, and she probably resigned herself to saying, you know what, I'm going to be with him for this amount of time. This is my assignment. I'm going to do what I have to do, and then he's going to go and do whatever he's going to do. But Naima had to know that she was a part of that. Who was it? What was the comedian's name? The guy from In Living Color, the only white character that was on there, the one that became more famous than all the rest of them, Jim Carrey. Jim Carrey said, "Behind every great man is a woman rolling her eyes." He's like, he really think he did something. He don't know he walked out of here with his drawers on outside of his pants. But you know, Naima, she saw something in John Coltrane. And you know, so for John to write this song about her, I think was just very, very special. And she was a very special woman. And she doesn't get talked about nearly enough. So I made sure that I put this in my repertoire. I wanted to play this to honor not just John Coltrane, but to honor her. So yeah. So this is for Naima.
Real good. Yeah,
I was going someplace. This is Naima. Hope you enjoy it. Thank you. Thank you very much. Luca Alemanno, Kevin Cannon. So much. Thank you. Tell all your friends we're here. Thank you. Luca and Kevin, thank you very much.
Thank you.
killer, Mr. Kevin Canner on the drums. The legend on the bass, Mr. Luca Alemanno. Luca Alemanno. And just to clear up any confusion, he's from Italy. Nobody knew that last set. They couldn't figure it out. I was like, where is he from? Is he from where? They couldn't figure it out. He's Italian. Doesn't matter, he's a bad motherfucker. That's what matters. That's all I care about. So thank you so much for coming to check us out. We're am I allowed to say that on the live stream? Am I allowed? Okay, cool, all right. I guess they'll bleep it out later. At some point. It ain't TikTok, right? So TikTok has just destroyed the entire world. You can be held responsible for, like, there's so much information out there. If you don't know, you just don't want to know. You're just not trying to know. That was It Could Happen to You by Jimmy Van Heusen, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong, or don't. Okay, so the next composition we're going to play is by the great Thelonious Monk. We love playing Thelonious Monk's music in this band. And in fact, Luca insisted, because he seems to think this is his band. So I said, okay, I guess we're playing Thelonious Monk's music, which is fine by me. He insisted. So we're going to play something that Thelonious Monk wrote called Work. And nobody seems to know what Thelonious Monk meant by a lot of these titles. Like, he would just come up with these phrases and these words, and people were like, okay, fine, whatever. But I tell you one thing. Work has taken on a whole new meaning since this pandemic. The lack of it and the work that has come out of it. And well, we're still here. Like, we're surviving this thing. We're surviving this thing. It ain't been easy. I've got some people, God bless you, that said that this is the first performance that they've come to since we've opened back up. Thank you so much for coming out. Folks have not been going out. We're not designed to be closed off. Even the introverts like myself, we're not designed to be just completely closed off from people. You gotta have some, you know, some human contact. So we're getting there. We're not there yet, but we're getting there. So just keep on working. Or as my father used to say, waking. Keep on waking. So this is Work by Thelonious Monk. Hope you enjoy it. Thank you. Kevin Cannon on the drums. Luca Alemanno on the bass. Thelonious Monk's composition work. We're going to change the vibe a bit and play a composition written by the great Noel Coward. And interesting thing about Noel Coward, I teach down at the University of Tennessee. And I'm not trying to, you know, trash my students at all or trash the young generation or anything like that. But this generation has pretty much no idea who Noel Coward was. And I'm not, like I said, I'm not judging them for that. I don't say, you need to know. I don't come at them that way. That's how some of my teachers came at me, and I didn't appreciate it at all. And I don't want to lay that on my students, but I do want to impart the importance and the significance of just musical history in general. But Noel Coward is not a name that you really even hear about all that much. So many different things going on, and things change. It's all good. But he was a great songwriter, and he wrote this song at a time. It was about 1932, and the lyrics he wrote were quite risque. Noel Coward was, in his circles, known as being openly gay, but he kind of pulled a fast one in musical theater and in Hollywood with this particular song, with these lyrics. And he just kind of snuck one in, like the real hip ones, like, you know, George Cukor and Billy Strayhorn and Lawrence Hart. They knew how to slip them in and get them past the cognoscenti, you know, the people who were running shit, you know, the Hays Code and all of that. Anyway, this is a composition that he wrote, beautiful composition that he wrote. You might recognize it from there was a Levi's commercial. Okay, so you know what I'm talking about, with Dinah Washington singing that from like 1962, I think. But the song was already 30 years old by that point. So this is called Mad About the Boy. I know it's stupid to be mad about the boy, but. He goes to all these. It's just really a wonderful song, very clever lyrics. So we hope you enjoy our arrangement of Mad About the Boy. Thank you. Kevin Cameron. Luca Alemanno. Thank you very much. Thank you. We're going to move on to a composition. This is an original composition. I originally wrote this for the great Bud Powell. And it's sort of a letter. And I just call it Dear Bud, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the music starts to play out in a way that is meant to express all the things that I'm thinking and feeling about Bud Powell. But in essence, it's really a song for most of the musicians, the artists, people that we know and love and or respect, revere, admire, that we might not have known personally, that had that struggled, you know, while trying to be artists on this earth, while trying to express themselves, while trying to be artistically and musically whole while struggling as human beings. And we all have some struggle or another. But these particular musicians, when you think about people like Bud Powell and Thelonious Monk, Billie Holiday, Amy Winehouse, Kurt Cobain, you think about these artists who had so much to say musically, but personally and socially, they couldn't quite get it. Couldn't quite get it together. You know, they for what any number of reasons, perhaps they might have been too much for this earth, or they belonged on another planet. You know, you think about some of these artists, and you go, gosh, how is it possible that a human being could hear that kind of stuff? Like Stevie Wonder. Now, Stevie Wonder seems to be pretty well balanced. Right, he got lucky to be blind and to be that brilliant of an artist, but some kind of way he managed to escape scandal. You know, he managed to avoid so many of the pitfalls that so many artists fall into, and people in general. Artists don't corner the market. Kevin, would you say artists don't corner the market on crazy? Right. Yes, you just said like an hour ago. We're back to eating cheese and meat. You said artists don't corner the market on crazy.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly. You say, now you remember, right. And, you know, oftentimes people ask me, oh, you know, well, how come so many black jazz artists, you know, struggled with drugs and had all these problems? I said, it was a drug culture. It was the 1940s. It wasn't just black jazz artists. It was white jazz artists. It was also Hollywood. Nobody ever talks about Judy Garland or Errol Garner, not Errol Garner, Errol Flynn, excuse me, or all these Hollywood people, you know, when it comes to the drug culture, what was going on at the time, but they always want to talk about black jazz musicians. It's like everybody was doing drugs. They were all doing it. Just we got the worst of the shit. You know, that's what happens. That's what happens. So anyway, this letter is for all those people who are long gone, anybody who's struggling now, you know, trying to figure it out, trying to create in a world that doesn't really care about you or understand you, and they get lost in the shuffle. This is a song for them. So it's called Dear Bud. Hope you enjoy it. And thank you for letting me bring the vibe down in the room. I appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you very much, Kevin Cannon. Luca Alemanno. Thank you. Kevin Cannon on the drums. Luca Alemanno on bass. Thank you, Thelonious Monk's Evidence. We're going to play a composition. I will always be someone who, I love the history of this music and I love the great and wonderful musicians that have played it, going all the way back to Scott Joplin and Louis Chauvin and Tony Jackson and Jelly Roll Morton, all the way up to today with Gerald Clayton. How about a hand for Gerald Clayton? Talk about some contemporary musicians. Gerald Clayton. Making so much noise. Beautiful noise. You know, the Bible says make a joyful noise. But making so much noise as not just a fine and individual musician of the greatest proportions, but conversations with him are always very enlightening and encouraging and motivational. He doesn't just talk about the regular shit. Have a conversation with Gerald Clayton, you're going to learn something. And just enjoy his energy and his presence. And, you know, he's part of the lineage. You know, we'll be talking about him I won't be talking, but somebody's going to be talking about him 40, 50 years from now. But, you know, and I like to celebrate musicians past and present. And that's no secret. So this composition is by one of the late greats. Some musicians, when they check out, as we like to say on the scene, they checked out. They didn't die, they checked out. They leave here quietly and then that's kind of it. But when this cat left, I don't know, it seemed like he took a lot with him. And it was only after he had died that I realized how much I was influenced by him in my writing and in my playing. And this is the funny thing, because he was such a, it fits perfectly with who he was. He was just a very laid back individual, very unassuming, very quiet. You barely noticed him unless he actually spoke. And he was just one of these subtle kinds of guys, but he had like a real sledgehammer kind of humor. He'd zing you quickly. But I'm talking about the late, great Cedar Walton. Cedar Walton, missing terribly. But this is a composition that he wrote called Groundwork, which was a feature that he wrote for the great, another legend that left us, Mr. Billy Higgins. And it was much faster. It was conceived at a much faster tempo. But generally with me, I like to slow things way down to try to get inside of the music, get inside of the chord changes and the melodies and figure out all the subtle intricacies and things like that. And then sometimes I just don't speed them back up. So Cedar Walton happened to hear a group I was working with playing this particular version of this composition, and he just fell in love with it. And to have the guy that wrote the song hear your arrangement, and he wants to hear you play it. I mean, that's, you know, Cedar Walton's the kind of guy I talk about. He's one of the few musicians who could have played a whole week at a club, two sets a night over six nights, and never repeat one of his tunes. That's how many songs he had written. And all through the week, you'd hear something new. So this is a composition of his, and this is an arrangement of mine entitled Groundwork. Groundwork. Hope you enjoy it. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Kevin Cannon on the drums. Luca Alemanno. Thank you very much. Composition by the great Thelonious Monk entitled Thelonious. We're gonna slow things down a bit. And I think this is where we're going to bid you adieu. I don't normally end my sets on ballads, but I think, at the age I'm at, that's kind of what I'm gonna do. Because I'm tired, man. I ain't, look here. My father used to say the things I used to do all night, now they take me all night to do. Look here, it's got no wind to fold them. It's just time to fold, Charlie. So we're gonna end on a beautiful note, a medley of, and I could play ballads all night long, but like folks will fall asleep, but I don't wanna do that. This is a composition by Horace Silver entitled Peace. And then we're gonna go into something that I know you are all familiar with. So thank you so much once again for Luca Alemanno, Kevin Canner. Thank you again for coming to hear us. We appreciate you. And hopefully we'll see you tomorrow night. Thank you very much. Luca Alemanno.
Thank you.